Go to the definition of rūpa, page number 6. Page number 6, definition of rūpa. In the Sanyutta Nikaya, the Kajaniya Sutta of Sanyutta Nikaya, Buddha gave a definition for rūpa as rūpati tiko nikavi rūpa. Rūpati. So in English, we normally, the scholars have translated as monastery. So what does it mean, rūpati? Rūpati means, now we up to now we discuss, now rūpa exists in kalapas, not as one different individual elements, realities. We take this as kalapa. So these kalapas exist in generations also, we say. And this generation is protected by tejo. So in some cases, when excessive tejo or some other element, especially tejo, attacks or strikes at these rūpas, for example, we say tejo, for instance, strikes it. Tejo is also, tejo means tejo doesn't exist alone. Rūpa kalapas with excessive tejo, when they strike at these rūpas. What happens? Because of this influence of the new rūpa kalapas, these rūpas, during their short momentary existing moment, in within these rūpa kalapas, there happens a stress and unstability. It means the patavyapo tejo vayo comes into an unstable status during their sports short lifespan. So what happened? So there happens a change here. Change doesn't mean that that rūpa kalapa, hard rūpa kalapa with more patavi becomes liquid. No. There happens a certain instability. So that instability, what happens? It makes the generation of rūpas, because these rūpas, before they pass away, they create new rūpas. These new rūpas will not occur in the same manner as they used to be. The reason is, there happened a certain change. So change happens within that rūpa kalapa which gets struck. Right? Which gets struck, if I draw it with the larger, since today this is rūpa kalapas. So they are struck by tejo, other rūpa kalapas with more, right, more heat. Then what happened? There occurs a certain change here. Because of this change, the new rūpa kalapas which occur in them, their nature becomes slightly, it changes. So there are two types of changes which happen. One change is that which happen in these rūpa kalapas, we call it that instability at that moment. And then their generation starts to change. So these two changes are called rūpana. Rūpana means gets molested. What does it mean? When struck by opposing or different factors, rūpas change. they change in their short momentary existence. At the same time, they change in terms of their generation. So the realities which undergoes these types of changes are called rūpa. For the rūpa to be, to turn something to be as rūpa, so there should be another important requirement. That is, it should have the nature to be struck by other qualities. It means this rūpa, only because it can be affected or struck by other rūpas, then it can undergo change. The mental qualities like citta cetasikas, which are immaterial realities, are not subject to these kind of clashes. So therefore, even though the citta changes, when the weather conditions change, our mind change. When something happens to our lives, families, our mind changes. So there is a change. Citta changes more rapidly than rūpa, and its change is very obvious. That's why our emotions goes up and down time to time. But we still, the Buddha didn't call it rūpa, rūpana, because it's not only the change what he was referring to. He was also referring to a change which happens because of a certain strike. So this strike can happen based on because of tejo, heat, cold, because of sun rays. Sometimes he mentions about the hunger, thirst, and biting of snakes, gadflies, mosquitoes. So these kinds of external, or it can happen internally within our body also. These kinds of rūpas causes the generation of rūpa to change. So the definition of rūpa means the realities which undergo these two changes. What are the two changes? The momentary change when they are struck by other elements, and the change that happens in generations. So that is what is explained in the definition of rūpa. I have given the Pali quotation and the translation. If you go to 2.10, it's number 10 of this chapter, 2.10, we see, according to the above explanation, rūpana is twofold. The slight change that happens within the rūpa kalapas that are struck by external elements, the change that takes place within the generation of rūpas, right? Within the generation of rūpas. So this is how the rūpa is explained. And another definition, 2.11, another definition for the term is rūpa yatiti rūpa, vinapi nāmena attānam pakāsi yatiti attoti. Realities which manifest themselves is called rūpa. It means these realities can be known without being named. The example given in the commentaries is, for example, even two people are sitting in the same couch, we cannot know the other person's mind. Maybe he is thinking evil about us. Maybe he is thinking good about us. But only we can know it unless we have the ability, psychic ability, to read the other's mind. We cannot know what the other person is thinking. So mostly nama, the mentality, is known through expression. The person will say, I thought about you in this way, I had such a feeling, and so forth. But the rūpa in the other sense is different. When we are sick, when we get some damage to our rūpa, everyone can obviously see it. And also the rūpa can be observed through the five senses mostly. So most of the rūpas are seen, can be experienced. So it means it gets manifested by itself. So that's the meaning of rūpa iti rūpa. So this is also another explanation. And also in the footnote of the previous page, I have given how the Sanskrit equivalent for the rūpa and how the Buddha has changed this, how to say, definition, right? And it has changed, how he has changed. So this was conspicuous characteristic in Buddha's teachings. He used to alter the meanings of the already existing terms and embody his philosophy into the the already existing terms. So then we go to the next topic, momentariness of rūpa. Momentariness of rūpa. In the Anguttara Nikaya, Buddha mentioned that he doesn't see any other reality that changes as the consciousness does. Consciousness rapidly changes. And he says it is not easy to give an example, simile, for his rapidness. So based on this, the Buddhists consider citta is more faster and changes rapidly than the rūpa. So then rūpa is slower in terms of its change. So in Theravada tradition, they explain rūpa lasts for 17 mind moments. it means 17 times than the rupa, than the chitta. So the exact time, how long the rupa exists, you cannot find in the canon. So this, even this explanation given in the commentaries for the existent time of rupa differs from each other. Sometimes it says 16, sometimes it's 17. So this shows there was no actual consistency about the lifespan of the rupa. The thing is, according to the Buddha's teachings found in Anguttara Nikaya, we can come into a conclusion according to the Buddha's idea. Rupa exists for longer time than the chitta, because he says, I don't see any reality that changes like the chitta does. So the exact lifespan, how long it remains than the chitta, is something not found in the canon, but in the secondary literature, even in the Abhidhamma canon, we cannot find this, how long it is. In the commentarial literature, we find it is 17 mind moments. And also in the Mula Tika, the sub-commentary, based on the information given from the ancient teachers, he prefers it is 16 mind moments. So there is no consistency in this regard, how long the rupa is. And then these 28 rupas have different, like mostly it is 17 mind moments, but some rupas have different lifespans. I have given it in the paper, so I'm not going to read it out, right? So it's for your further reference. So there are two opinions how the rupa is, lifespan of rupa is explained. But the thing is that this Theravada tradition, we explain that rupa is also momentary. It rises and passes away very quickly when considering about the time. Then we come into the causes of origin of rupa. It's page number 8. 2.18, causes of origin of rupa. According to the Buddhist teachings, rupa can origin based on four causes. There are four causes for the rupa. Kamma is one, chitta is one, uttu is one, ahara is one. Kamma, Buddhism is a philosophy which is greatly influenced by kamma. You cannot talk about Buddhism without kamma. Kamma is one of the major fundamentals in Buddhism. Major fundamentals are kamma, rebirth, past life, and conditionality. So kamma also falls into conditionality. So relation from life to life, the unarisen suffering, anuppanna dhamma we discuss. So these are the fundamental, very fundamental pillars of Buddhism. Nibbana. So without kamma, without next life, the Buddhist teachings is not practical. So whether the life exists or not, it's a different matter. Different case, that's something that we have to verify by ourselves, because which cannot be empirically provable to others. So anyway, the kamma plays a huge role in the Buddhist teachings. So the Buddhists understood kamma is one reason for the arising of rupa. So these rupas which arise based on kamma are termed as kammaja rupa. It's termed as kammaja rupa. So this kammaja rupa also you don't find in the suttas directly. But when you go into books like Abhidhamma or Patisamvida Magga, we find the kammaja rupa explanation. So it is assumable that from the Buddha's time, this idea of kammaja rupa has come, because the kamma plays a huge influence. And also in many suttas, he mentions how the rupa changes based on kamma. If you go to Nakkana Sutta, he mentions that the 32 marks of a great man that he possessed are because of past kammas. So like by the influence of kamma, he clearly mentioned in many suttas, but you don't find these the tiny material qualities which are named as kamma, but we can easily understand the influence of kamma is greatly mentioned in the suttas. But in Abhidhamma literature, we find rupas which are produced by kamma, chitta, uttu and ahara, right? Clearly we can find it. So rupas which are produced by kamma are called kammaja rupa. And then they are all together 18. So if you go to the next page, 2.19.11, kamma samutthana is another synonymous for kammaja rupa. I have given a detailed, lengthy explanation for this for your references, and especially for the MA students, they can use these references for their studies. And I'll be reading only a few of these further classifications. The main classifications are kamma born matter, chitta born matter, uttu born matter, nutriment born matter. But there are some other minor secondary classifications, right? In 2.912, we have kamma paccaya. Kamma paccaya is synonymous for kammaja rupa, and sometimes kamma paccaya means the gross body parts of living beings, such as hair, skin, tail, and horns, and so forth. Because the thing is, according to the Buddha's teachings, These rupa we possess are greatly influenced by the karma. Because for example, if someone is handsome, good looking, it doesn't mean that good looking rupas are kamaja rupas. Actually, what they see as a complex, mostly as a complex and attractiveness, is based on the utuja rupas. Because that's why normally, according to the teachings, when some person dies, the kamaja rupas in his body completely disappears. Kamaja, chittaja, aharaja rupas doesn't exist in a dead body. But the appearance remains the same even after death for few days. The reason is, therefore, the rupa that we see mostly in our body are productions of utu, heat. That is also, which was started from the mother's womb, generations. So therefore, that these rupas that we see as attractive or defects based on the past karmas are not the kamaja rupas. So the thing is, these rupa are greatly affected by karma. So a term for them is kamma pachya. Kamma pachya means the body parts, the gross body parts we see, because they are greatly influenced by the kamma, right? But under the fourfold classification, they fall under utuja rupa, right? Utuja rupa. So if you go to the 2.19.15, there are two types of another definitions. Kamma pachya utu samuttana. It means in the kamaja rupa kalapas. Kamaja rupa also lies in kalapas. In these kalapas, there is tejo, heat. That heat will produce another rupa kalapa. That is called kamma pachya utu samuttana. The second kamma pachya utu samuttana is what I want to emphasize. Kamma pachya utu samuttana means, according to the commentaries, the mansions, the food that the normally the devas get because of their past karma. So Buddha mentions that when you have done lots of merit, you are born in the deva realm and you enjoy lots of pleasures. So in the one sutta he mentions that these deities are called kamma palupa jivi. Kamma palupa jivi means they don't need to work hard to earn their living, to earn their food like humans we do. For a human, if he wants to have food, he has to work for that. He has to farm it. But the devas get it by their kamma. That's called kamma palupa jivi. It's a very nice term. Kamma palupa jivi. Ones who live based on the results of their past karma. So the deities who are born in divine realms, they get the food not by working hard, because of their, past life karma. Their mention is made on past life karmas. There is a story about one person has given dana to the Buddha and Sangha, and it's mentioned that his mansion already appeared in the deva realm before he died in this life. So likewise, according to the Buddhist teachings, in the deva realm, the luxuries you get, personal luxuries, not the divine abode. Personal luxuries you get, your mansion, the food and so forth are creation are because of the karma. But they are in terms of four classifications, like karma, the four basic classifications: kammaja, utuja, chittaja, utuja, aharaja. Based under these four classifications, these rupa, kamma pachya utu samuttana, fall into utuja rupa. They are actually utuja rupa, but they are influenced by kamma. Right? They are influenced by kamma. So these secondary classifications are like mixtures of the major classifications. Right? The major classification. So then we come into another classification. We should go to the next page. Chittaja rupa. The cause is chitta. Chittaja rupa means material produced by chitta. Influence or produced by chitta. It means, for example, these chittaja rupas are present or evident in our lives. In many cases it is evident. Very distinct cases are when we get certain emotions, we normally experience. When we get anger, our heat, temperature of our body increases. So there is an influence to the rupa from the chitta. So Buddhist literature we call these are the rūpa which are produced by citta. And also when we make the deliberate movements, physical movements, our body becomes lighter. So that's why we come into mood. If you observe by yourself, when we make the initial movement to change our posture, there is a certain lightness which happens. So this lightness, according to the Buddhist literature, is caused by the citta. So therefore, these when the changes which happen in the body during emotional changes and also while making deliberate physical movements, the citta, the rūpa produced by consciousness become more evident, right? And then if we go to the sub-classification, 2.19 to 4, we find citta paccaya utu samuttana. Citta paccaya utu samuttana means, so citta rūpa, if we take this as citta rūpa, that citta rūpa also have tejo dhatu. That we cannot exactly say its location, but it is it exists there. Because of this tejo dhatu, another rūpa arises. That is called, because the initial rūpa produced by citta, citta rūpa, the second rūpa is produced by utu of this rūpa. So we call citta paccaya utu samuttana. That's how the second classification. The emphasis I want to give is the second citta paccaya utu samuttana. Citta paccaya utu samuttana can also refer to the forms, the monks or the people who have psychic powers. They can create forms. Like according to literature, they may form an elephant, they may create an elephant, another human, another mansion. So these are not permanent or lasting rūpas. They are created by the, by their psychic powers. They may last for a long time according to the literature, but they are still created by their psychic ability. So these rūpas, which actually falls under utuja rūpa, are greatly influenced, created by the citta. So it's called citta paccaya utu samuttana. Another citta paccaya utu samuttana means when we make the sounds like clapping, when we clap, we create a sound. This sound is made out of the clash of the two parts of the body, so it's a utuja rūpa, but with the involvement of our mind. So that is also can be called citta paccaya utu samuttana. It means utuja rūpa, because of the clash it happens, right? And it's initiated by the mind. So likewise, these four classifications, kammaja, citta, utuja and aharaja, have many sub-classifications with involvement of different causes, right? Involvement of different causes. So then we come to the next one, utuja rūpa. Utuja rūpa is the rūpa which is produced by the heat. Which is produced by the heat. So this is the rūpa that we find according to Buddhist literature. All the inanimate things, the non-living things, starting from trees to the rocks and seas and the earth and so forth, which are non-living things, are created by these rūpa which are produced by utu. Not by kamma, not by citta, not by ahara. So this utuja rūpa is found in inanimate things, in animate lives, in our lives, in the body, also utuja rūpa. And sometimes when the weather condition changes in our body, there happens certain different rūpas start to happen. They are also called utuja rūpa. So utuja rūpa also, it's detailed explained. If you go to 2.19.34, in the next page, page number 11, 2.19.34, sometimes in a general sense, in the commentary explains, the clouds are called utu samuttana. The rain which falls from the cloud are called utu paccaya. And then because of this rain, the trees grow, the water level of the sea increases, sometimes the smell comes out of the earth, so these are called citta utu paccaya utu samuttana. So likewise, there are various ways of explaining the rūpa based on the causes. So the thing that, what we have to emphasize, according to the purpose of these kind of classifications, is just to show all the rūpa are conditioned. To show that rūpa doesn't happen without a condition. These lengthy explanations facilitates the yogis, the Buddhist yogis, to contemplate, understand rūpa is nothing created by God. It doesn't happen automatically. Always there is a cause, reason, condition for the arising and sustaining of the rūpa. That is the purpose behind these classifications. So we go to the next page, page number 12. We find oja, ahara as the cause. Then we get the aharaja rūpa. So aharaja rūpa also should be known very clearly. So sometimes when we eat lots of food, we get fat, or our body starts to grow. But this growth is not the aharaja rūpa. This growth is, according to the Buddhist literature, the fatness we see, the increasing of the flesh or the hair and all these are the transformation of the food that we eat. According to Buddhist literature, what we eat is come from the outside, this is uttuja rūpa. These uttuja rūpa digest in our body and they transform into small particles and they go into the different places of the body, and these are the rūpas that get transformed into flesh and these cells, according to Buddhist literature. Ahara the rūpa means when we eat the food, we get a certain strength in the body, we get an energy in the body. This energy, this strength protects the body, makes our body to function properly. This is the ahara rupa. That is a very important point that we have to be clear about. Ahara rupa means the energy or the energy that is created while we are partaking food, right? Partaking food. And a sub-classification of ahara rupa, if we go to 19.44, it says ahara pachya utu samuttana. Ahara pachya utu samuttana means these energetic rupas also have tejo dhatu. It will produce another rupa. The next ahara pachya utu samuttana is gathering of two causes, ahara and utu. It means we eat some food and then we get certain weather conditions. Like after eating certain food, if you go in under the sun, sometimes our body starts to get react. So these kind of sickness, these kind of difficulties, the rupas which happen in our body are called caused by both food, ahara, food, and also by the weather condition. So likewise, all these explanations are given to show that rupa is conditioned by various causes, right? You can refer it by read by yourself. So then we come to the consciousness versus corporeality, which is also a very important aspect. Consciousness, chitta versus corporeality, rupa. What is the difference between chitta and rupa? The foremost difference is chitta cognizes an object and rupa does not. Chitta cognizes an object, the rupa does not. If you go into the, there's explanation given in the Mula Tika that the difference between chitta and rupa is mainly because the chitta process, the mental process can work to arouse certain qualities. There's an intentional attribute in the mental process. Because of these intentional attributes, we work to arouse saddha. We work to arouse certain mindfulness. We can work to arouse wisdom. So likewise, there is an intentional attribute application for certain activities. To arouse certain qualities, to associate certain people, to associate or a certain food or certain weather conditions, these kinds of intentional involvement is found in the in the mental stream. But in the physical stream, rupa, there is no such type of thinking. So therefore, rupa does have effects of the causes. Based on the karma, based on the weather conditions, based on the mind, rupa changes. But it is not an intentional way of change. Then a question may come, if we are talking about intention, is Buddhism advocating a self? No, self is different, intention is different. In Theravada Buddhism, they accept the intentional force in the mind, which call it chetana, volition. But it's not a self, because self has to be explained separately. I'll be discussing this in a different lecture, the attributes of self and also how the Buddhism deals with this concept, right? So the thing is, there's an intentional sort of involvement attribute in the mental stream, but in the physical stream, there is no such intentional force. And also there's a subjective experience. Subjective experience means the aramana, rupa is object is taken by the chitta. So this subjective experience becomes distinct in some places. For example, if we take the memory, if we recall something back, it's normally in the scientific field we call it the information retains in our brain and it is retaken by the brain. If there is no such thing called a consciousness, so according to the Buddhist theory, only the material thing cannot have the subjective experience. What do I mean by subjective experience? So when we, for example, we read about an information which is historical information that we didn't experience. For example, we read some information written in a book. We get the information. But think about an incident that we also experienced. We recall that incident. So in these two incidences, we get the information. By reading a book also, we get the information. By being there, recalling, we also get the information. But in the two occasions, when we are reading a book, we don't get that feeling of I have been there. We don't get the feeling of familiarity. We don't get the feeling that I have known it before. But when you recall it, there is a certain attribute of familiarity about the information. So that is the difference between citta and rupa. That is the difference when the citta is present. So if something is not subjectively experienced, what happens? If even we get the information, it's just an information for us. So if only rupa is doing the, because rupa doesn't have this kind of information, because if it's only retained in the brain and the information comes out of electrons, we don't get this feeling of familiarity. So therefore in Buddhist doctrine, they strongly advocate that there is a consciousness apart from the rupa, then this consciousness doesn't have the attribute of knowing or cognizing an object. We can call it a subjective experience. So therefore, that is the main basic distinct between rupa and nama, that rupa doesn't have the cognition ability, the nama has the cognition ability. In Buddha explained this point in the Mahanidana Sutta. In Mahanidana Sutta, he explained there are three ways the self idea can occur in a person. Three ways. It's sometimes some people can call Vedana itself. Vedana self means self experience the object, self feels the object. So instead of Vedana, we can call it feeling. Feeling is self. Then, and some person may say self, one who doesn't feel is the self. Feel is the self. Another person may consider self is with feeling. So these are the three ways in Mahanidana Sutta you can find. Buddha says, Atta Samanupassana, a person may consider about the self, come to the idea of self in these three ways. In some suttas you find like a person consider rupa as atta, vedana, sanya, sankhara, vinyana. He explains it's 20-fold. Here he explains it's 3-fold. But they are not contradicting. They can match with each other. So here feeling itself is considered vedana. As I said, vedana is the chetasika which has the most involvement with the object. We normally know chitta chetasika arise together. But among these chitta chetasika groups, Vedana is the reality which experiences the object in a whole manner, in a holistic way. Passa, the contact touches the object. Sanya recognizes the object. But Vedana tastes the object, its flavor, and it is like, it is explained in the Buddhist literature, like taking the object as a whole. It means it goes into the object, it feels the object. So this feeling is considered as the most active means conspicuous, we can say, it experiences the object in the best way than the other mentality. So therefore, feeling is the most reality that appeals most for a person to consider as I. So then Buddha gave explanations why he doesn't accept this idea. He says, when feeling sukha, he says feeling is three. If someone says feeling is I, he instructed Venerable Ananda, ask these types of questions. He says feeling is threefold, sukha, dukkha, upekkha. When sukha feeling is there, he considered there is no dukkha and upekkha feelings. So when dukkha feeling is there is no happy or intermediate feeling. When there is upekkha feeling is there is no happy or unpleasant feeling. So he says if someone considers feeling as self, when sukha vedana is there, dukkha, adukkama sukha vedana are there. When the adukkama sukha vedana appears, the sukha vedana disappears. Then he said, you have to consider, if you consider feeling as I disappears with the feeling, with the happy feeling. So says, there is no such a, when we say I is a one thing, it doesn't arise and fall. The idea of I is not like that. So I'll discuss this matter in a different lecture. So he refuted the idea with this argument. But this argument, one who does not feel, he just said a very simple explanation. He gave a very short answer for that. When he said, Ananda, is there, if any reality doesn't have the attribute of feeling. If it doesn't feel, how can you get the idea of I? That's only the answer he gave. So what is his intention? The commentary says, this one who does not feel means the person is referring to the rūpa as I. Rūpa atato samanupasati. Out of the 20 modes, he is referring to the rūpa as the I. So Buddha used to say, if there is no feeling in the I, he is referring to the rūpa. There is no idea of I self. So what his intention was, rūpa does, what I want to emphasize here is rūpa doesn't have the cognizing quality or feeling quality. So the third way of to conclude this part, the self with feeling, he is referring to the other three aggregates of sanya, sankhara and vijnana, which is together with feeling. Well, that's the first distinction between rūpa and nama. If you go to 2.21, another distinction between corporeality and materiality is the prior gets molested. We already explained that. Rupana, while the latter does not. We already explained this. The mentality doesn't get struck by other realities. 2.22, as mentioned under 2.1 in the first paragraph, when material qualities come together, they manifest material attributes of physical things. They appear as things. On the other hand, mentalities do not manifest, so even they exist in clusters. Mentalities also appear in clusters, but they do not manifest as things. So these are the three main distinct differences of nama and rupa according to Buddhist literature. What are things? The main thing is the rupa doesn't have a cognition, nama has a cognition. Then the rupa manifests as things, the nama does not, and rupa gets struck by other things, so it comes molested, it gets molested, it jumps into change, the nama is not liable to struck by other elements. Then another point is 2.23, the dependent origination. There is a causal link called vijnana paccaya nama rupa. Vijnana causes nama rupa. And also Buddha in the Mahanidana Sutta mentioned nama rupa causes vijnana. He gave these are anyamanya, these are mutual relationships. He explained. So here the nama, in the you can see in the Vibhanga Sutta of Sanyutta Nikaya, nama is explained as chetasikas. Chetasikas means it's explained as vedna, sanya, sankara, living vijnana. Rupa is the four great elements that we are discussing now. Vijnana is the chitta. Right? So what does this say? Vijnana greatly depend on rupa. Rupa also greatly depend on vijnana. So when we say vijnana, if you go to the Mahavedala Sutta, I have given the references, it says, the Venerable Sariputta says, vijnana cannot be separated from vedana, sanya and other mental qualities. Especially he mentioned about vedana, sanya. Different places he mentioned about panya. And also if you go to Anupada Sutta, it clearly says that these like effort, chanda, these chetasikas arise in the vijnana, are together with vijnana. So according to the Buddhist teachings, chetasikas and vijnana happen together. So what does it mean? This causal link shows that rupa depends on the nama, the mentality depends on rupa. There is a mutual relationship. So when the nama is supporting the rupa, in Abhidhamma perspective, we call it paccaya jata paccaya. Paccaya jata paccaya means it's given in the handout. It means it's the mentality supports the sustaining of the rupa and for the growth of rupa. At the same time, rupa supports nama as basis. In Abhidhamma perspective, we call it the nissaya paccaya. It becomes the basis for the chitta to happen. So likewise, there is a mutual relationship with nama and rupa. So there is a clear distinction. At the same time, they are very important in the mutual relationship. So according to this explanation, it seems like so nama and rupa are very fundamental requirements for all the lives, but it is not so. There are two types of lives which only exist with rupa and only exist with nama. If you go to the Sangeeti Sutta, expounded by Venerable Sariputta and praised by Buddha as to be one of the wonderful expositions given in the Buddhist traditions. So Buddha praised this sutta. In this sutta, Venerable Sariputta says there are a certain kind of beings who doesn't have any feeling, who doesn't experience any object. So these are the beings in our literature we call asanya satta. Asanya satta are the beings who doesn't have any chitta. Asanya satta. And also in the Potapada Sutta, when the Potapada asked the question about the life, Buddha mentioned, I advocate three types of life. Three types of life means a life with a very gross life like we have in the karma realm, Manomaya life, which are the rūpa life, rūpa vachara lives, and then he makes arūpa, immaterial life. So some people think that the immaterial life has a very subtle kind of a rūpa. That subtle kind of a rūpa you can find in the Manomaya, because the first life is called gross life, that the rūpa we have here. The second life is Manomaya. Manomaya means production of the mind. Mind is a jhana chitta. We have a jhana and we are born in the Brahmarin. That life is a production of mano, jhana mano, chitta, mano chitta. So then the third life, that life has a very subtle rupa. Third life is arupa. Arupa means no rupa at all. So therefore, there is another being called arupas. Arupa beings. So these beings are either asanga satta beings have the rupa and arupa beings have the nama. So even though the vinyana pachya nama rupa causal relation is explained in Nalakalapi Sutta, in Mahanudana Sutta, and it is explained in many places in the vinyana supports the nama rupa in the Sanghita Nikaya, but we have to understand that this is not valid for certain lives. So therefore in the Nalakalapi Sutta commentary, depending upon this information found in the Pottapada Sutta and the Sanghiti Sutta and in the Yamaka of Abhidhamma, the commentary says this relation of Nam Vinyana and Nama Rupa is only confined to the Panchavokara realm. Panchavokara realm means the realm which has the five aggregates. Arupa realm has only the mental four aggregates. Asanya Sapta has the only Rupa material aggregate. Right. So then we go into the another subtopic, page number 14. Causes for the sustainment and growth of corporeality. Sustainment and growth of corporeality. I'll just hint in the points because I want to conclude the lecture with little information. So causes of the sustainment and the growth of corporeality. Jivitindriya, in the first paragraph it says Jivitindriya, life faculty, is necessary for the continuation of Kammaja Rupa and also for the other Rupas as well in the life. Then the next reason is the consciousness. As we explained in this course of relation, consciousness is necessary. Buddha mentions without the consciousness, Nama and Rupa doesn't sustain or doesn't come into growth. The rupa doesn't grow without the chitta. That's why when the chitta is gone, chitta is no more in the body, it starts to get rotten. So therefore, consciousness is also a very important factor for the growth of rupa in animate life. Then we come to the Mahaparinibbana Sutta. Buddha mentions, a person who has developed certain spiritual faculties called iddipada. If he wishes, he may be able to sustain his rupa for a longer time. So therefore, spiritual faculties, according to Buddhist teachings, are also reasons for the sustainment of the rupa. Then we come to the next paragraph. It says the suitable weather conditions in the bold letters, I'm talking about the bold letters, suitable weather conditions are obviously necessary for the rupa to continue. And heat produced by the past kamma, we call this kamma the tejo. So this kamma the tejo in the Buddhist canon is explained as usma. I have given in the footnote the gatha found in the Sanghita Nikaya. Buddha mentions this ayu, which is jivita indriya, usma, the heat produced in the commentary literature, we say is produced by kamma. And then the vijnana is the necessary factors for the rupa to life to continue. So therefore, this kamma jatejo is also a very valid, vital requirement for the life to sustain. Then medication, so it's also mentioned, with some medication we can keep our rupa for a longer time, which is also very obviously proven these days. Then four types of, the next paragraph says oja, the nutriment, the oja is also necessary for our life to sustain. Then wholesome and unwholesome deeds also support for the continuation of our rupa. You can see this, the Buddha mentioned in the Dhammapada. If someone pays respect to the venerable people, venerable ones regularly, his ayu, vanna, sukha, bala increases. It means his rupa, nama rupa can sustain without problems when he keeps on doing wholesome things. The kamma is also a requirement, and also the kamma we have done in the past lives also supports for the continuation of rupa without much hindrance. Then we come to the causes for the various appearances and capacities found in corporeality. So that the differences, the main difference between in animate things is the bhava rupa. Causes by masculinity and femininity. That's why females and males have different appearance, different manners in the physical activities, and also they have different shapes in their body. And then the next one asks for the doctrine of karma. As the Buddha has explained, people get pleasant, unpleasant appearances and abilities, capabilities based on the karma. We can see this in Lakkhana Sutta and Chulla Vikamma Vibhanga Sutta, it's clearly explained. Then we find another law called Yoni Niyama. Yoni Niyama means, whenever Lady Sayadaw explained this point, he says, this is the law why the people born in a certain, beings born in a certain species, get the attributes of their genetical parents. Because of their genetical parents, attributes are transformed to the life, like with genes. This is called the Yoni Niyama in the Buddhist text. Then this, then we can, another way is Kamma Vipaka Jayadi. This is something that is unique to different species. So that's why certain creatures can fly, stay in the, under the water. And also, according to Agnya Sutta, Buddha mentioned, the people, humans who are born in the beginning of this kappa could travel by sky. So these are all categorized under the Kamma Vipaka Jayadi. They are just laws, natural laws, which are found to different species. Then we come to rūpa and pahana. Pahana means abandoning. According to the teachings, rūpa is nothing to be abandoned. Only the defilements are to be abandoned. But in the Sanyutta Nikaya, Buddha mentions notion of abandoning rūpa. He mentioned to Venerable Radha, if you want to abandon the rūpa, just abandon the attachment to this rūpa. In that sense, you will abandon the rūpa. So when we say rūpa is nothing to be abandoned in terms of fourfold functions, but rūpa can be abandoned in a certain manner, pariyayana, in a certain manner. If we cut the rūpa, attachment towards the rūpa which has not arisen, we discussed in the last lecture, anuppanna dhamma, which has not yet arisen, will cease without arising. So rūpa, that is the way to abandon the rūpa. Then we find, we also discussed about three universal characteristics in the last lecture, about the anicca, dukkha, anatta characteristic. But in the rūpa, we find another specific characteristic called asubha. Asubha means, which is found only in the living beings of the karma realm. Though this asubha characteristic is not found in the deva realm, it's not found in the brahma realm, and also what we had mentioned, this asubha characteristic is not an ultimate quality. Because for example, if we take the most repulsive things in our life, body, like excrement, when we consider it in terms of four great elements, the repulsive idea disappears. Another characteristic, apart from the three universal characteristic, is the asubha characteristic, which upon which the meditation of Buddha has instructed monks to develop concentration and get into higher spiritual quality. So these are the points that I want to emphasize with regard to the rūpa. So I'll be concluding the lecture with two more facts about that I want to emphasize based on these information. So in the beginning I mentioned that the rūpa as material attributes. Attributes mean just natures, qualities, characteristics. So also it's mentioned that in the text we find rūpa as things, right? Rūpa as things. So how do we understand this rūpa as material attributes? Very important. So it shows something that the Buddhist philosophy beneath the teaching. So that's why I want to just to emphasize this point. And also I want to emphasize how the asanya and arupa sattas can be found in the Buddhist canon. So these two are the concluding remarks that I want to give based on this lecture. For example, when we say, for instance, when we come into, I explained in the, if you go to the previous paragraph, that is 2.3, we mentioned that the rūpa is explained in three ways in the Buddhist doctrine. That is, as things with abandoned material qualities, as things which has a peculiar, unique material quality, and as just mere qualities. So when the Buddha mentions about the hair, skin, and so forth, he was referring to things, but with abandoned qualities. So why he could group them in a one group as patavi? Because they had the distinct hardness. Why he could define certain liquids as apo? Because it has the liquidity. So likewise, the grouping happened because of certain mental attributes. So then the eye, ear, nose, these things he didn't consider as patavi in some explanations. So why he didn't call patavi? Because it had a very specific, unique attributes of being sensitive with the object. So that is also one way. Then in the Ayatana Dhatu classifications, he just just want to emphasize the mental attributes. Why do I say so? For example, the same example I'm taking, which I took for flesh or skin, I would call it skin. So skin is the completion that we can observe. So in terms of dhatu, we can observe the skin by our eye. So when we observe the skin by our eye, we have to call it rūpa dhatu, because it can be seen. And if we touch the skin, we have to say it as pottabha dhatu. Pottabha dhatu. So why do we name the same thing? So if something can be seen, it is rūpa dhatu. If something can be felt, it should be called pottabha dhatu, right? It should be called pottabha dhatu. So if we call the same thing the rūpa dhatu and pottabha dhatu, because we know in some suttas, Buddha mentions about chakkuncha paticca. If I say chakkuncha paticca rūpecha upajati chakku vinyana. Right, chakku vinyana. So if we just call the skin, only the skin as rūpa, and all the most of the skin as pottabha, because the thing is, the same skin can be seen, same skin can be felt. So if we name the skin as the rūpa and the skin as the pottabha as a thing, what happened? This explanation can be contradiction, because we know chakku and rūpa because of chakku vinyana arises. But if we take this as a thing, what happened? Instead of saying rūpa, we also should be able to call it pottabha. If you're referring to the same thing, but this kind of, if we say chakku plus pottabha, go to chakku vinyana, this is a wrong explanation. Why we say this is wrong, and why we cannot write such a formula? Because if pottabha and rūpa dhatu refer to the same skin, instead of saying rūpa dhatu, we should be able to call it pottabha. But this kind of formula is not possible in Buddhism. Why the reason? Buddha was not referring to the thing in this classification. Why we can boldly say, definitely say this classification is wrong? Because in this formula, he's not referring to the thing. He's referring to the attribute of color, which can be seen in the skin. When he say kaya pas pottabha, refers to kaya vinyana. So here he is focusing on the attribute of can be touched, the tangible quality. So otherwise, if we just call the skin the thing as rūpa or pottabha, we should be able to say kaya plus rūpa brings kaya vinyana. So why we cannot say formula? Because in these qualities, why we can clearly say is because he sees in the same skin, he sees two qualities. That is the quality which can be seen, quality which can be touched. So in these classifications, he was mainly focusing on the qualities. So that's why I also want to say this quality, the material quality, is something that governs the doctrine of rūpa. So based on this material quality, sometimes he defined the rūpa as things. Sometimes he defined the rūpa as things with peculiar qualities, and some cases he defined the rūpa as just material attributes, right? Just material attributes. But in this, all these three types of classification, which governs the whole doctrine of rūpa, is rūpa as material attributes, right? So then I come into the next last point of this lecture about the asanya satta and arūpa. So asanya satta and arūpa, normally, sometimes people confuse, is there is a possibility that there can be a being without rūpa and without nāma? Because in many sutta, Buddha explained about nāma rūpa. But there is clear evidences. In Abhidhamma books, Yamaka, it says about the life without rūpa and life without nāma. It has lots of evidence in Yamaka. But in suttas, we go into the sutta called Mahanidāna Sutta. So this Mahanidāna Sutta contains an information which gives a very logical assumption about a life without rūpa and life without nāma. So in Mahanidāna Sutta, he explained about viññāna kṛti. Viññāna kṛti means the abodes where viññāna exists. The meaning of this viññāna kṛti means the places where viññāna exists. Viññāna kṛti. So he mentioned vinyana, seven vinyana kiti. What are the seven vinyana kiti? Ekatta kaya, ekatrasanni. It means some beings have similar body, and similar sanni here refers to the vijnana, right? Because it's the topic is vijnana kiti, but he was referring it as sanya. So they have a similar sanya or similar patisandhi vijnana. Then we have ekatta kaya nanatta sanni. Then we have nanatta kaya ekatta sanni. Then we have nanatta kaya nanatta sanni. So this Nanatakaya Nanatasanyi, he gives examples in the Sutta. I call the Ekatakaya Ekatasanyi is Patama Jana Brahma, so forth. He gives a detailed explanation. Who are the beings he wants to define under this category? Then he comes into another three types of vijnana. It's called Nevas Akasananchayatana. Akasa Nanchayatana Sanni. Then we have Vinya Nanchayatana Sanni. Then we have Akinchanayatana. So these are the seven Vinyana Titi the Buddha mentioned. So if you look into this, you find the first four is not only Sanni, it's not only about the Vinyana. He is also referring to Kaya. Kaya is Rupa. So these are the four types of beings who has Vijnana and Kaya both. From the seventh one, he doesn't refer to any Kaya. Why is he doesn't refer to? Some may think that these beings have a subtle Kaya. No, because in this Ekatta Kaya, Ekatta Sanyi, he mentions these are the Brahma realm. Brahma beings who have very subtle Rupa. He called Ekatta Kaya, Ekatta Sanyi. So these Brahmas, which are very subtle rupas, still he considers them as having a body. So the Ekatta Kaya Nanatta Sanyi is the second jhana, third jhana Brahmas. Brahmas of the second jhana realm. Because they can be born in the third jhana and second jhana. Then Nanatta Kaya Ekatta Sanyi is who are born in the animal realm. Because they have a similar patisandhi, but they have different appearances. Humans and the Devas of the Chatur Maharajika realm, they have different appearances, different patisandhi chittas. So he doesn't only give the names, he also gives the explanation which beings he are referring to. Then he comes into three vijnana titi. He is talking about people, beings with vijnana, but without referring to kaya. What does this say? This says these beings doesn't possess any kaya. Do they possess the subtle kaya? If someone says subtle kaya, we have to explain how the Brahmas became ekatta kaya. Because Brahmas have a very subtle kaya. Buddha say, even the Abhyapaja Brahmas, Devas, Abhyapaja Devas with the discussion with Kosala, Abhyapaja Devas cannot see the, Abhyapaja Devas cannot be Abhyapaja Devas. It means the Devas cannot see, how to say, Devas who have anger, cannot see the Devas who doesn't have anger, who Brahmas, Devas cannot see Brahmas. So Brahmas have the subtlest rupas in the world, but still they are categorized under the kaya. So therefore when he mentioned vijnana titi without kaya, he is referring to the arupa realm, beings without kaya. Then the discourse doesn't stop here. He mentions, he was starting vijnana titi, the places where vijnana exists, and he says there are two more. He says these vijnana titi and dve ayatana. So dve ayatana, he refers asanya satta, neva sanya, na sanya. Neva sanya, na sanya. So it's very important why he made them out of the vijnana titik. So when the Buddha makes a classification, he doesn't make out of nothing. He has a purpose. So these are the above places where vijnana exists. And he says these two, apart from this vijnana titi. So to take them out of this vijnana titi, There are the two reasons. Asanyi, no vijnana. Because sanyi, you can see, sanyi refers to vijnana here. All the beings are defined with sanyi, who has consciousness. But here, asanyi doesn't have a consciousness. Then the next one is become more clear. Neva sanyi, na sanyi. Neva sanyi means, I don't want to call them, they have a sanya. At the same time, I don't want to call them, they don't have sanya. What does it mean? Their sanya is so subtle. So they doesn't fit to be called, they have a sanya. At the same time, they doesn't call fit to be, they don't have a sanya, because they have a certain sanya. So their sanya chitta is more subtle than all the vijnana titi. So when he was referring to vijnana titi, he took two beings out of that group. The reason was, some beings doesn't have a vijnana, a sanya, it's very clear here. Then neva sanyi na sanyi, if you define this word, neva sanyi na sanyi means neva na sanyi na asanyi. Neva sanyi na asanyi. So what does this mean? So you can see all the places, there's sanyi, sanyi, sanyi. You have chitta. Neva sanyi means na sanyi. They are not, I don't want to say they have chitta. Na asanyi. Asanyi means the one who doesn't have chitta. So I don't neither want to say they call them they don't have chitta. I neither want to call them they do have a chitta. It means their chitta is so subtle that they don't fit, it doesn't fit to be called into vijnana titi, and also it doesn't fit to be called, it doesn't have vijnana. So this teaching found in the Mahanidana Sutta is a very clear illustration to my understanding, to show that there are certain beings without the chitta and there are certain beings who are without the kaya, right? Who are without the kaya. Why do I bring this point here? Because it's related to the rūpa. So when we say rūpa, I'll conclude the lecture, rūpa is something related to our lives. And rupa is something to be observed in terms of vipassana, and rupa is greatly related with chitta. We cannot talk only about rupa in human life, it's always related with chitta. So then we come to the existence. So nama rupa paccaya vijnanam, vijnana paccaya nama rupam, they remain together. So this is a very basic fundamental in Buddhist teaching. But this fundamental should not be applied to all the lives. Because certain beings possess only rupa, certain beings do not possess rupa. So when someone possesses only rupa, this is related to the rupa chapter. If someone doesn't possess rupa, this also related to the rupa chapter. That's why I want to bring this into discussion. So these are the concluding remarks that I want to emphasize. So this corporeality lecture so would end with here. So if you have any one or two questions, you can raise. Otherwise, I'll conclude the lecture and I'll meet on next week, Sunday. I'll be doing the consciousness as the